Open the pod bay doors, please, Hal.
And what'll he be doing in the meantime?
You don't understand.
I understand that he's 23 and you're 35, Bill. 35 in this business, you're an old man.
Look, Julie, they're building this kid up, feeding him a lot of pushovers. If I can get over him tonight, that'll mean a rematch. That's a semi-windup, 150 guarantee. Maybe a top spot, even.
Top spot?
Yeah, a top spot. And I'm just one punch away.
I remember the first time you told me that. You were just one punch away from the title shot then. Don't you see, Bill? You'll always be just one punch away.
The pod bay doors are open. Thank you very much for joining us once again here in this corner. I am your host, Doug Heller, film critic and film historian for TalkMovieToMe.com. And in the other corner, weighing in at three websites, ArmchairOscars.com, ArmchairCinema.com, and OverthinkingOscars.wordpress.com. Jerry Dean, the Mean Machine Roberts. Four?
Three.
Three. That's what I thought.
Three.
All right. How are you?
I was owed some and I didn't get it.
And let's not forget on Friday, there will be a wrestling match held here for the first time in Paradise City. They will be wrestling in a ring filled with fish. Fresh fish. We're talking about Robert Wise's The Setup from 1949.
That is an actual quote from this movie.
Yeah, it is. this was my pick to round out our unofficial boxing month. I got to introduce Jerry to it. It's a great movie. It's a direct ancestor to Raging Bull. I know how you came to it. What did you end up?
I didn't know what to expect because anytime you watch a boxing movie anytime you watch a boxing movie before Rocky, mm-hmm. It usually deals with the world of boxing.
Mm-hmm.
Most movies do. Rocky dealt with the personalities, but most movies deal with the world, the business of boxing, the squalor of the boxing world. And what surprised me was how insular this world is.
Mm-hmm.
In this movie. It's Paradise City. It's in New York. And it's interesting. Now, this movie, one of the interesting things about this movie is it takes place in real time. It's an hour and 12 minutes.
Three years before High Noon did it.
Long before, some other movies have done it. I know there was a movie in the 90s called Nick of Time that tried mm-hmm. to do that. That actually advertised itself as doing that.
Right.
But it's really, really hard to do a movie in real time.
Yeah, it is.
I think Wise actually filmed, because several times through this film, five or six times, you see a clock.
Right, but he shot multiple different clocks for the different scenes with different times, mm-hmm. so that when he was cutting it together, they could drop those in at the certain markers, and he would be covered, so he could. It wasn't like an accident or whatever the length was, wherever that scene fell, he had a shot of a clock that would cover it within the time frame of the movie. Only an editor could think of that.
Yeah.
Like,
only the editor of Citizen Kane could think of that.
The editor of... It's amazing how much... When you're watching this, when you see something like The Sound of Music or West Side Story, you don't really see the influence that working on Orson Welles' first two masterpieces had on
Or Star Trek, or
The Andromeda Strain. You don't see the influence it had on Wise, but when you watch this, or like Return of the Cat People or something in his early career when he was still at RKO, you can see what he picked up and where from Wells just from cutting together his footage.
The language of this film is all in the editing.
Mm-hmm.
Because the dialogue in this film, it's almost all plot driven.
Yeah, well, it's a noir, and it's short noir.
So it's mostly just plot driven. Mm. So the dialogue is only to get you to a different, to the next point. There's not a lot of development here. So a lot of it is the language of editing. It's the language of, especially that boxing match at the end.
Mm-hmm.
In which you keep cutting back and forth to different people and different things, different reactions, to the changing tide of where the boxing match is going.
Right.
Because this is a movie, we talked about Rocky, we talked about Raging Bull, in which movies in which the boxing takes place in the ring.
Mm-hmm.
You are, in this movie, largely outside the ring.
Right, you're in the bullpen. What this does is it shows you the world of the grinder matches, the people that are never going to get beyond going from city to city, having a bout for four rounds. This is exactly where we were at the beginning of Rocky, where Rocky was at the Love beginning. Fighting. Right. So, you know, they get four rounds and you've got, the people in one corner in one locker room and the other ones on the other side of the stadium in the other locker room, and you know, they're talking to each other, they're taking their time, they're getting ready, they're just kind of, because they all know each other. And I want to point this out right at the top, this locker room in 1949 is integrated. There is actually a black fighter in there. There's no problem. Everybody likes him. Everybody talks to him. He's just Luth, you know? And I loved that. You know, it's kind of beautiful that in 1949 that was shown.
Well, this was New York. So there was a
I thought it was out guy. West.
I thought it was in New York. I thought
well, because remember, Luther's talking about, he said, once I get through this, then I'll go back east to Philadelphia, and then I'll have a few more fights, and then I'll get my title shot.
I thought I heard something in a commentary that said it was in New York. I could be wrong.
I don't know. I'm going by what Luther said. I thought it was out west, but
well, they
doesn't matter.
It doesn't matter, but
it's a little town somewhere.
It's a little town somewhere, and if you notice, this town is within a couple of blocks.
Mm-hmm.
This area that they're in.
It's almost like a Western, but in 1949 noir.
It's almost like a Western, but it's one of those little... it's like Pottersville.
Mm-hmm.
There's a billboard. There's a billboard somewhere. There's always an advertisement for somewhere. There's a scam, there's a game, there's a hustle going on every corner. And it's a scummy little town.
Mm-hmm.
And there's alleyways everywhere.
Yeah. Dark alleys.
Dark alleys. And it's a nowhere town, and it's a no good town.
Mm-hmm.
But it seems to be centered on this nightly boxing match.
I think weekly, series. Yeah.
Well, this series of boxing matches that go on, and the funny thing is, the closer you get to this film, and I mean this sincerely, the closer you get to this film, the photography in this movie, the deep focus is absolutely stunning.
It's so gorgeous.
Because they look almost when you're looking at somebody, when you're looking at Robert Ryan or any of the other actors, they look almost three-dimensional.
Mm-hmm.
Because the focus is, because the deep focus is so good.
Mm-hmm.
And this is a gorgeously shot film.
Yeah, it is.
But it looks like it was made for $1.50.
Yeah, pretty much. I mean, it was an RKO picture in 49.
It looks like a TV production almost sometimes. What I got caught up in, because I kept thinking to myself, and we've talked about this in every show that we've done this month, the world that this takes place in the early part of the century, this is the midpoint of the century, boxing was a nasty, dirty, ugly hustle.
Mm-hmm.
It was a usually underhanded,
mm-hmm.
run by the mob.
Mm-hmm.
These little grinders, these little ham and eggers, these little guys that are fighting, are usually asked to take a dive because they have money on the fighter that they want to promote.
Mm-hmm.
So, okay, second round, you take a dive.
Right.
And that's the understanding. And if you don't, there are consequences.
Right. And unfortunately, in this one, man, it breaks my heart every time I watch this to know that Robert Ryan's manager takes just $50
for him to take a dive. Takes a bet on him at the very beginning, before we even meet him, takes a bet on him to lose. Because he has so little confidence in him, just takes a bet on him just to lose.
Mm-hmm.
And
then you find out that that's the setup.
Yeah.
He carries him for two rounds and then he goes down in the third. And
they got this kid that they want to promote. They got this young kid, Tiger Nelson.
Yeah. But what breaks my heart is that, like, okay, yes, I know it's 1949. There's a recession on, a post-war recession. But $50, like, this is low stakes.
That is really low ball in your
That is just, it breaks my heart. It's like, yeah, here's the whole 50. I'm like, oh, man, he's not even getting $100. Like, and they don't even tell him.
No, you're
because
not even
they're
getting 75.
Yeah. I mean, and they don't even bother to tell him because they're just, he's just so sure that there's no way he's going to win. And
do they ever talk about his record? Because
I think he and his wife do. I think his wife brings that up and she's like, you're always one punch away and you're always going to be one punch away.
One punch away. But they never talk about his record, how apparently he's very good, because, I mean, he's still boxing at 35.
Right, but he's been doing it for 20 years. He's been boxing since he was 15 years old. And he's never made it past these grinders. Like, he's not that good. He just can't do anything else. And, It's tragic that they just have no confidence in him, but then the cut man is like, yeah, we better tell him because there's no telling what he might do. Like, I think he's kind of erratic. I think he could pull a win from nowhere every once in a while.
That's that little roly poly.
The guy that looks a little bit like Mickey Rooney.
Yeah. The little roly-poly guy that's in his corner with the Q-tips.
Late Mickey Rooney. And, you know, he gets rallied because he just doesn't want to lose again. And he's told at the end of the third round, look, there's a setup, you need to go down.
Yeah, they wait until then to tell him that
because
when he's winning.
Because he's been holding out for so long. It's kind of
wait until he's in the corner
before the fourth round. Yeah.
And he's bleeding from the eye. They wait, and he's winning.
Uh-huh.
And they wait until then to tell him. I think he's been knocked down once.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a point after that when he gets knocked down. He's on the mat, and you're looking at him, and the referee is counting, and he keeps hearing the voices in his head.
Mm-hmm.
And it's his common sense, his sense of self-preservation is wrestling with his dignity. Mm-hmm. And he keeps hearing the wife's voice in his mind, and then he keeps hearing, you know, it's like he's wrestling with himself.
Right, without the fresh fish.
Without the fresh fish.
I love the gimmicks that they put up in this. But this fight is more brutal than I think most early boxing movies were.
Oh, it's a street fight. They're just pounding away at each other. There's no boxing technique in this at all.
No, it's all very, very brutal. And I love when you're in the locker room waiting and the one guy
I want to talk about this.
Yeah. The guy who's just like, you know, this middleweight champion, he got knocked down 21 times in a row. He lost 21 fights in a row, and then he became the middleweight. Yeah, poor Gunboat. Yeah. And he's like, yeah, that's how I'm going to do it. If I can keep losing, but I can still hope that I'm going to be the middleweight champion, because this guy got beat 21 times, got knocked out 21 times in a row, and then he became the middleweight champion. And he goes out there, and a minute into the second round, he is knocked so cold.
He gets brain damage.
Yeah.
Because he starts talking basically to ghosts, and he just kind of starts rambling. Because they bring him back in, the guy's face looks like hamburger.
Yeah, I mean it did before he went out there.
Yeah, but I mean the guy's been fighting so much, his face looks like hamburger.
And he, part of me, thinks that he said that they're like, what's your name? And he says the name of the middleweight champion. Part of me thinks that he was kind of half calling back to, this is how I'm going to, this, I can still get a shot. And another part of me was, that was the last name he said before he went out. So he right. might think that that's actually who he is. So right. it's hard to tell whether that's a hopeful ending to Gunboat's story or a very tragic ending to Gunboat's story.
I think he's got brain damage.
Well,
it's now here's the funny thing. Here's the thing. Luther is out there for almost the exact same amount of time,
mm-hmm.
and Luther wins. And he comes back in. He's got a weld over his eye, and yet he's smiling and he's like, "Hey, I won."
Yeah, I told you I could do it. And that kid, that high school kid.
Yeah. Oh, the one with the Bible.
No. The really young one, with the neat haircut that throws up before he goes out there.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
He's like 17, 18 years old. It's his first professional match, and he's got like a high school jersey on. He's got like a high school robe on, and he's just nervous. He wins, too.
You know what I thought of? I thought of Gladiators.
Mm-hmm.
You remember that scene in Spartacus when Kirk Douglas and Woody Strode are sitting in the pen, and it's right before they have to go fight each other, and they're looking at each other, and they can hear the battle outside,
mm-hmm.
what they're going to have to do to each other.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I thought of. I thought of Gladiators in the pen.
Yeah.
They're about to have to go and kill each other.
Right, because, you know, in the next town, they could be in opposite locker rooms.
Right.
Matched up against each other.
Right.
You know? It's that whole, I love the whole locker room sequel. Cause that's most of the movie, mm-hmm. is seeing Robert Ryan getting ready from suit to trunks, you know?
Well, and then the language of what's going on in his mind.
Mm-hmm.
He keeps going to the window
to check the hotel across the street, because he can right. see the room that he has with his wife.
To see if she's left.
Because he gave her a ticket. She's like, no, I have a headache. She can't bear to see it anymore because he keeps getting What did she say the last time? The last time it took him like 2 hours to even remember who she was. He was concussed so bad.
Yeah, why would he give her a ticket to that? It's like, why would he think she would want to go and see that? I kept thinking of the first Rocky movie when
with Adrian,
she stays in the locker room.
Uh huh.
And that's a wonderful place to stay during a boxing match, by the way. But yeah, she stays in the locker room, and you know, because she doesn't want to watch him get his brain
right,
beat
right.
out.
And maybe for a while she was okay with it, but now as he's getting older, because they've been together for a while, as he's getting older, it's getting worse and worse and harder for him to recover. And then we need to talk about the crowd, because the crowd is as big a part of this as anything else.
I was gonna bring this up because you get familiar with the people in the audience, because there's different people. There's a guy who he looks a little bit like Jack Webb or something. He's sitting next to his girlfriend, and he's so involved in the fight at the end that his girlfriend asks for a light, and he can't even take his eyes off the thing.
Oh, right, because he's there, like, punching.
Right.
And you get the woman who, like, outside, she's with a friend and their husband, like, another couple. And
yeah,
she's like, I don't know why he keeps dragging me to these. And then she's in there, and she's like, kill him! Kill him!
Yeah.
She's, like, the most hardcore out of all of them. There's a blind man who gets the fight described to him by his companion, which
he's
apparently
a fat man. There's a fat man who single time we see him, he's eating something different.
Eating or drinking something like a hot dog or a hamburger.
But it's always something different.
Always something different. It's always
there's a guy who he's got a radio up to his ear.
Listening to a ball game while he's watching the fight.
Listening to a baseball game. There's all these different characters they keep cutting to. And they're always there.
Yeah, I think it really makes everything much more real.
Mm-hmm.
Like you get to see the boxers, but you don't get to see the opposing locker room. You're only in the one with Robert Ryan. And when you're outside of that, you get to see all of these different people who you would expect to see at an exploitation fight like this.
Yeah.
The blind man is the one that interests me the most. Apparently, Robert Wise actually saw that happen. Because he would go to these little grinders for research for the film. And he saw the guy with the radio and the listening to the baseball game. He saw the blind guy. The blind guy doesn't seem to have a favorite of who's fighting, just whoever's winning. Like,
yeah.
he'll you know, and now he's up against the ropes and he's got him bleeding. Good, good, good. And then, oh no, now Stoker's, come on, Stoker, get him. It's like, he has no real conviction other than picturing the carnage in his mind, which is
like
really
the,
disturbing.
It's kind of like, I live in a football town, so, it's kind of like when the fans are with their team and they have loyalty to their team as long as the team is winning. But when the team starts losing, they have nothing to do with it.
See,
that is
not how it is up here in Pittsburgh. Mm-hmm. But we have three professional sports teams.
Yeah.
We have football, hockey, and baseball. Mm-hmm. And there are Steelers till they die, no matter what's going on, people up here, which is most of everybody.
In the state of Alabama, it is college football right into the grave. I mean, it's for somebody who doesn't follow any of that, who stands outside of it, it's fascinating. Just like the boxing in this movie.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not into boxing. I don't understand it. It's a scummy little world.
I love boxing movies.
I love boxing movies.
Real boxing is just horrifying.
This world, let me tell you, while I'm watching this movie, you could just, it sort of grosses you out when you start doing a sensory sort of mental play in this movie, when you kind of put yourself in it. You can almost smell the rancid cigars, the old beer, the
and
body
the
odor.
Sweat and the yeah.
I got that. Oh, I got that even when I was watching Rocky. When it was in that first match, I was like, "This place must smell rancid."
Yeah, yeah. And if you're in the first few rows in the Raging Bull fights, yeah,
you're gonna be covered
in the splash zone.
Ugh. It's just sort of a gross little world. I thought about that, you know, the few blocks from this arena is just the worst sort of human waste.
Right next to it is a dancing hall, and we all know what happens in 40s
dancing
halls.
40s.
Nothing but prostitution rings and
dime a dance kind of things. It's Pottersville.
Yeah, it's everything that you see in, like, the. It's a noir. It shows you the less glamorous side of everything and anything.
It's one level up from the hell of a Gaspar Noé film.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
Although I think Irreversible could happen in one of these dark alleys.
Yeah. Just a couple of blocks over.
Yeah. Yeah. So let's talk about the end. So he's set up. There's a setup. He's supposed to go down.
That he doesn't know about.
That he doesn't know about until it's too late, and then he can't reconcile it with himself, so he doesn't do it. He beats the kid.
And it's like they wait until the fourth round when he's been beaten to a pulp and he gets in the corner, then they tell him about it.
Right, because he's winning and they didn't expect that. And then his really generous, nice manager and cut man
leaves
bolt before the round is finished, so that he is left to deal with little boy, the gangster himself. And he can decidedly plead ignorance because he was not told about this. They leave him to possibly die.
They leave him in the locker room, and the cleanup guy tells him, you know, cut the lights off when you leave. And he doesn't. He leaves the lights on because they don't want him to know that he's left.
Right, so he tries to go out the other side, but at the same time, his wife keeps looking out the window because she can see where the locker room was, and the light's still on, and she's getting irritated or worried because she thinks that he might still be in there getting revived or something. She doesn't know what happened.
Everybody else, by the way, has left.
It is dead empty.
Everybody has headed for the hills. They are gone for the they're not anywhere near this. And he tries to sneak out. He doesn't even change his shoes. He just puts on his suit. He heads out. They meet him in an alley.
beside the boxing ring, behind the Paradise City Athletic Club.
Mm-hmm.
And they beat him up, and they break his hand. Boxing career over.
They did him a favor.
Yeah, in a lot of ways. But here's the part that got under my skin every time I see this. When what's her name? Judy?
I think so.
Finally comes up to him and she's like, "Oh, Stoker, are you okay?" He's like, "They broke my hand. I won tonight." And she goes, "We both did." It's like she is happy, basically, that he got messed up beyond belief after a boxing match and got his hand broken. It's like, we both won. That's a really odd way to look at that. Like, that's a really...
She was thinking about leaving.
Yeah.
Because she was standing on the bridge watching the streetcars.
And she tore up the ticket and dropped it in a beautiful, in a beautiful match cut. I mean, just a stunning. You see her tearing it up, and
Julie.
Then Julie, And when she drops it, it immediately cuts to her point of view, and you watch the ticket scatter over the streetcar. So beautiful. And you see her wandering around this nowhere dive town.
One of the things that I noticed, I saw this a couple of times. One of the things I noticed was that when she goes, she's trying to take her mind off of it.
Mm-hmm.
There's a point where she goes into an arcade. And by the way, a 1940s arcade is fascinating.
Yeah. Pinball, skee ball.
Yeah. Claw machine,
yeah. But
she goes into this this little arcade. She's kind of, in a lot of ways, trying to take her mind off because she starts smiling when she watches these people doing, just having fun, mm-hmm. doing different things. And then all of a sudden, she sees a display that looks almost like Rock'em Sock'em Robots.
Mm-hmm.
Two boxers, one knocks the other down. And it sort of puts her back in mind of what's going on, and she leaves.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like it knocks her back into reality.
Yeah.
That's a really interesting visual.
Mm-hmm.
Because the little mechanical man knocks the other mechanical man down.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, oh, yeah, that.
And, yeah, she goes... I think I've said this before, but I love watching old movies when they actually say how much something costs. She gets two hamburgers, two cans of vegetable soup, and two beers. And he's like, that's $1.13, 3 cents for the governor, so it's $1.16. And she's like, $1.16? I'm like, $1.16?
Did you notice how much it was to get in the fight?
No.
Because the entire roster of fighting is $2. One match is I think it's $1.50. See, I think the whole thing was $2. I think three matches was like $1.50. One match was 50 cents. So it's like... yeah.
Back when a dollar was a dollar.
Back when a dollar was a dollar. Yeah, I'm glad you introduced me to this because I really love this movie.
It's
not a whole lot to talk about. But.
There's not, but it's fascinating in the way that it's like you said, it's only an hour and 12 minutes, but it is packed solid.
I tried
front
to start
to back.
I tried to start this last night at 9:05, but I tried to start this to see if I could run it in real time. But it didn't happen. But it's interesting the use of clocks. In this, I don't know where the time motif really fits into this. It's an interesting gimmick.
I think for me, it means that there so much can happen in so little amount of time.
Right.
He went from a loser who hasn't won a boxing match in a long time, who's about to kind of lose his wife if he can't get out of the life. And an hour and 12 minutes later,
he won
a match, got his hand broken by the mob, and got his wife back in a very short span of time.
And regained his self-respect.
Yeah. He can retire on a win.
And move on to something else.
Right. And most of those fighters can't do that. They either get...
Especially Luth.
Yeah.
Luth is going to keep doing this until either they give him brain damage or somebody kills him.
Mm-hmm.
Because he's not going to have another opportunity to do anything else
right.
other than this.
Right.
So it's a really interesting film. I'm going to be honest, I didn't really get it the first time I saw it. Because I thought, this looks like something that turns up at like midnight on TCM. You know, and I think it
has shown up at midnight on TCM.
Probably has, but well, they had a night one night when they showed a lot of boxing pictures,
mm-hmm.
and this is the one that it didn't have time to get to. But they showed, I think they showed Rocky, they showed Raging Bull, The Harder They Fall,
which is so good.
My favorite, which is Champion.
Excellent.
And then this. And such a... Boxing movies are so interesting.
They
it's
are.
Interesting because it's interesting because the characters, you're always fighting for self-respect in a lot of ways.
You know, and it's funny that boxing movies are the really the only sports movies that I end up liking because there's more about humanity and personality in boxing movies than there are in, the rest of them usually just focus on the big game or whatever. But boxing, it's always more than just one match. It's not...
Well, in a lot of ways, it's because boxing is so easy to manipulate. Like we said earlier, you know, you can have the mob running a boxing ring and, you know, running, you know, manipulating who's going to win and who's going to take... versus who's going to take a dive. You can't do that with baseball, really. You can't do that with football. Mm-hmm. The one time they did that with baseball, turned up the Black Sox.
Yeah.
Which, by the way, got turned into a really excellent movie called 8 Men Out.
Mm-hmm.
But it's easier to manipulate because it's just one guy.
And it's usually one guy that needs the money.
Right, because they come from the bottom.
Mm-hmm.
You know, these little bottom feeders and these little grinders, and they're a lot of times down on their luck.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like I say, it's easier to manipulate and it's easier to make drama about.
Mm-hmm.
I love good boxing pictures. I guess we can move to recommendations.
Yeah.
I would recommend again. I'm going to recommend Champion, Kirk Douglas, which is. Mm-hmm. Wonderful
so
movie.
Good
again, just like Raging Bull, about another hateful bastard, but just it's a guy who just gets turned. He's a good man who just gets his brain just gets turned by the success that he has. Another one that I love, and a movie we're going to talk about later on this year, and I'm not going to give too much away, is Fat City.
Mm-hmm.
Made in the early 70s. Was it John Huston? John Huston, such a good movie.
He's one of my favorites.
What do you got?
I would reiterate The Champ with Wallace Beery and Jackie Cooper.
Not the remake. Not the remake with John Boyd. And
no.
Ricky Schroeder.
Nope. Not that one.
Yeah. The Champ with Jackie Cooper and Wallace Beery. It's a good movie.
Yeah, that was from, what, 31?
Mm-hmm. Won the Oscar for it.
Yeah. Such a great movie. And, like you mentioned, the bogey picture, The Harder They Fall. Mm-hmm. Wonderful. And The Harder They Fall is another kind of a boxing noir movie. Mm-hmm. And I think, as seedy as boxing is, it really lent itself to that kind of gangster noir.
Yeah.
It's great how you can put everything into that kind of an atmosphere. And which is what
they bring this film into film classes.
For good reason.
For good reason. You know, just because of the way it's photographed and the way it's edited. Like I said, this is all in the editing because there's not much story to deal with here.
And it's definitely like we were saying, that's you can see all the parts that Martin Scorsese was inspired by to use in Raging Bull. You can see certain shots that were later replicated in Raging Bull.
Mm-hmm.
Even some editing cuts that Thelma Schoonmaker would emulate to a point. So
glad he shot that in black and white. I am really glad he shot that in black and white.
Yeah.
And it's so obvious that he had this in mind when he made
mm-hmm.
When he made Raging Bull.
Yeah. Very much so. So that's what our recommendations are. What do we have coming up?
Next week we're moving into the month of love. And I'm going to start with what I think is, since we've already talked about my favorite romantic comedy, which is Annie Hall. We're going to talk about another great romantic movie called City Lights.
Yay. Which features a boxing match, so we'll be easing from boxing into romance.
This is not our first trip through Chaplin. We earlier talked about The Great Dictator.
But, yes.
And after that, we're going to... we're talking about To Be or Not to Be.
Yes. My favorite comedy.
Ernst Lubitsch.
Jack Benny, Carol Lombard. Oh, I love it.
Great film. And then after that, we're going to go back into my choice, which is another different kind of love story. We're talking about Midnight Cowboy.
Mm-hmm. And then to close out February, as I said last week, I was still deciding between Daughters in the Dust and Malcolm X, and I settled on Do the Right Thing.
A movie that is decidedly not romantic.
No. that's my Black History Month pick, because it's celebrating its 30th year this year, and it's really a stunning work.
And Midnight Cowboy is 50 years old this year.
Yep.
So that's what we got.
Mm-hmm.
You want to ring the bell?
Ding, ding.
I'm not going to stop doing that.
We thank you very much for joining us here on the Pod Bay Doors. You can find all of our back episodes at www.thepodbaydoorspodcast.wordpress.com. You can throw a tip into our virtual tip jar at Patreon at pod_bay. You can find us on Twitter at pod_bay. We thank you very much for listening, and the Pod Bay Doors are now closed.
The mission has been completed.
I am just a poor boy, though my story is seldom told. I have squandered my resistance for a pocket full of mumbles, such are promises. All lies and jest, still the man hears what he wants to hear and disregards the rest. When I left my home and my family, I was no more than a boy in the company of strangers, in the quiet of the railway station, when I'm scared. Laying low, seeking out the poorer quarters where the ragged people go, looking for the places only they would know. Lie-la-lie, 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 lie-la-lie,
stands a boxer and a fighter by his trade, and he carries the reminders of every glove that laid him down or cut him till he cried out in his anger and his shame, I am leaving.